Concentrated deposits where there's mining in just isolated areas, that is what has changed, because the concentrated deposits are finished. And so mining is actually going into places where there isn't so much of the concentrated products, it's a much bigger area, the technology, the water use, the toxification of these areas is absolutely enormous, because it's not just where you mine, but it's the wider impact into the communities and into the ecosystems. So that also got us thinking, and particularly Philippe really came up with the idea of needing to do something else to look at the other end of the spectrum. Because the first one was looking at the impact, directly the impact of mining on our Earth. And the second one is looking at the gadgets, as the electronic gadgets, which are one of the major drivers of mining. And that's what Philippe will talk more about. The purpose of tonight is to look at the amazing initiatives that are coming up. And I think that that's the thing that gives me hope after having really gone through the dark night of the soul with the research that Philippe did for us. The day that human beings allow technology to surpass their interactions with each other is the day we begin to build generations of idiots. So Einstein is quite amazing.
As Liz said, this report, Short Circuit, is coming on the heels of a previous report, Opening Pandora's Box, which was released last year. And in Pandora's Box, we took a kind of helicopter view, looking at the dynamics in the extractive industries, and big chunks of them, like oil, gas, coal, and metals. And what we found was that, number one, the pace of extraction in the last 10 years has been increasing a lot. Now, with Short Circuit, we are looking at one of the drivers of this extraction, and basically the consumption of electronic items. Now, we are being constantly told that these items are about connection, that owning one of them, I'm talking here about laptops and tablets, smartphones, owning one of them is a way to get connected to everyone and everywhere on Earth. And by doing so, the planet is a big happy place for us to enjoy. But I think we have to realize here that the connection we are talking about is what we could call a horizontal connection, connection between members of the same species, us. But what is totally missing is a vertical connection. Connection that would link back those items to Earth and Earth processes. We are mesmerized by the physical appearance of these machines, because they look very sleek and modern and clean, but we are totally oblivious of their physical reality. What we are trying to do is really to connect the dots, come up with a thread that looks at the complete life cycle of the product, from birth, life, death, and hopefully some kind of reincarnation. So I thought we could imagine a little smartphone, dead. And in ancient Egypt, when somebody deceased, he had to go he or she had to go in afterlife to face a judgment of Osiris, where his or her heart would be weighed and a series of 42 questions would be asked to judge the moral character of the dead. So here is our smartphone, casually discarded after 14 months of use by its owner, and is taken by Anubis, the psychopomp guiding souls in the afterlife, in order to be judged. So don't worry, I'm not going to ask 42 questions, but only 5, which I thought were quite relevant to the life of a smartphone, and that recoup the themes that we developed in the report. So one of those questions, the first one was, has thou lusted for precious metals? And yes, of course, these devices are full of metals, precious or not. And this is something we've been talking about in the first report, but in pretty general term. In the short circuit report, we look at six categories of metals, from gold to rare earth and the conflict minerals in the Congo and so forth, and looking for each of them at the environmental, social, and geopolitical problems they create. Next question. Has thou ever worked man or beast beyond its strength? Well, that takes us to China, mostly China, because that's where manufacturing is done. And there also we look at the social environmental impact of manufacturing. It's a well-known fact that Apple, the main bottleneck for Apple, for instance, is that they can't get enough products in the hands of customers at the time of launch. So they put a lot of pressure on their suppliers to come up with as many products as possible, and this creates its own problems, and we also look into that. As thou leave the full time allotted to thee. Planned obsolescence, obviously, is a big issue these days. Everything is done to reduce the life of these products as much as possible and to entice us to renew them as often as possible. As they understood that life ends only to begin. E-waste, recycling. The United Nations reckon that up to 50 million tons of electronic and electric waste is created every year. And a very tiny part of it is actually properly handled and recycled. Now, of course, after those four questions, our poor smartphone is not faring too well in front of Anubis. But there is a last question, which was the last of the 42. Is there one who is glad that thou hast lived? And to that we also have to answer, yes, of course. Millions, billions of people are happy to use these machines. So I think it's an important point that I want to make tonight. The report is not about demonizing those machines. It's about mindfulness. It's about being aware that we are part of a system that is basically designed to fail without giving second thoughts about the mountain of junk that is generated in the process. So I'll finish with Egypt and just borrow from another tradition to finish off. I'll tell a little story about the Buddha. One day, a man came to the Buddha and asked, "Sir, what are you and your disciples practicing?" And the Buddha said, "Well, you know, we sit, we eat, we talk." "But," said the man, "everybody sits, eats, and talks." "Yes," said the Buddha. "But when we sit, we know we are sitting. And when we talk, we know we are talking. So what does it mean for us?" I think it means that when we use a mobile phone, we need to know that we use a mobile phone. That is, we need to know the countless stories behind that phone that lead back to Earth and Earth processes. That being casual and complacent about the use and disposals of this machine is akin to ecocide, crime against the earth. Thank you.
I'm the co-founder of a new organization called the Restart Project. For those of you who have not yet been to one of our events, we organize twice a month in London Restart parties. What is a restart party? A restart party answers a question that I always ask to people when I meet them for the first time, which is, do you have something at home that needs fixing? Do you?
Yes.
So the thing is, most of us do. In fact, 99% of us do. And we no longer know what to do about it. We decided to do something about this for all the things that are electrical and electronic in our lives. Primarily being inspired by a desire to share knowledge and to rethink the way we approach those black or grey or white boxes that are more and more present in our lives. As Philippe said, we are more and more dependent on these gadgets, and they are so omnipresent in our everyday life. But we less and less are able to control how we maintain them, what's inside them, what does it mean. And that's not just a matter of looking at the, you know, there is blood in your mobile side of the equation. It's not just about recognizing the inequalities and the violence behind the production of these gadgets, but it's also a matter of empowering individuals and communities in regaining control of the things that they own. And by virtue of owning them, they should also be able to make effective use of them, which involves knowing how they're made, how they function, and how you can extend their life. So we started running these events called Restart Parties, as I said, which bring together our network of restarters, as we call ourselves, wonderful volunteers. Three of us are here tonight, who have a passion for sharing not just their skills, but actually to sharing why certain things happen and what we can do collectively to demystify these black boxes. And that's the most important thing. By doing events all together, we throw these events in community libraries, public libraries, in pubs, art galleries, and more recently, and that's very exciting, in universities and in schools. Everyone who attends not only normally gets something repaired at the events, it's for free, of course, so that's a driver, but that's really not about a free repair. It's about using that to engage people in a conversation about what was wrong with the device, how could I act differently to make sure that I don't despair, but I just repair, as we say in our slogan. So the point which occurred to me multiple occasions, having repaired or helped to repair and fix things for people in my family many times, it was that very often it's not something extraordinarily complicated, but it's something that appears complicated if you don't get, if you don't have someone who will hold your hand through the repair. So that's why we organize self-repair events where tools are available, for a starter. A lot of these gadgets tend to be built with very hard to find screws that have very complicated screwdrivers. I have a set that looks pretty scary. And they are built as much as possible to prevent users from wanting to try to give a go, because there are so many screws in order to take apart just this very laptop that it's really not designed to be opened by people, normal people. And yet, it can be done. It can be done, and it's wonderful when you realize that your laptop going really, really hot and making a horrifying sound does not mean that your laptop is at the end of its useful life, but it only means that you need to take it apart and clean its fan. And that will give it a whole new life of happiness without reaching tremendously high temperature. And that's just one example. We've started running courses. The most popular one so far is the one called Speed Up Your Laptop. It's wonderful because it's absolutely free, and it's something that once you learn how to do, you can do it for another 100 people. And it just means how to know why your computer is acting slowly, how to know how to clean the hard drive, to delete software that you didn't even know you had installed, plugins that it's unclear what they're doing there, etc., etc. And by doing that, a completely well-maintained laptop can be as fast as the new laptop that you would buy in the shop. In fact, why is this relevant? Because if you have a two-year-old laptop and you don't know how to take care of it, it will soon feel extremely slow. If you buy a new one, after another year, that new laptop is going to be just as slow as the one you're having. But if you know how to make it how to make your original laptop faster, that laptop will continue to be fast enough for your needs. Of course, at times it is needed to upgrade to buy a new product. We're not against that. And one of our repairers, restarters, once told me something that I found quite illuminating. There are times in people's life where when actually to buy a new monitor for your computer, it will make you feel good and you actually need it and it's going to bring joy in your life. That's fine, but let's make sure that that broken laptop or screen is taken care of, repaired, and given to someone else who actually might need it. We are quite deceived in thinking that to recycle something is the way forward. When we don't no longer need something, we are told more and more that we need to recycle it. Well, that's not really true. To reuse a computer, for example, is much more efficient in terms of pure energy. A United Nations University report affirmed that it is about 20 times as efficient to reuse a computer as opposed to recycle it. So the events we do are part of a wider plan that we have of bringing repair back in fashion. You've seen it everywhere. Repair shops have been closing down, squeezed by high rent costs and by the difficulty of repairing specific products. Manufacturers are not providing sufficient support. Spare parts are extremely expensive to the end user. We want to try to change this. So the events are just the tip of the iceberg, really. Because of course, community repair events, although we are growing in that sense, but there's only a fraction of the population that you can reach through them. But it's really encouraging to see that there is a wider movement happening around them. Restart parties are currently being planned in South Africa, in Italy, in the United States, in Spain, we're getting inquiries from France, and a few volunteers signing up from Malaysia and India the past week. One of the things we've been struggling is manufacturers don't want you to repair things you own. And to the extent that you can only find official original repair manuals for the things you buy, because someone somehow has leaked them on the internet, like on WikiLeaks. So we've been thinking about doing a WikiLeaks for repair manuals, because it would be probably quite interesting. You can't find that information. Of course, there's a retro engineering wonderful system that Kyle and his team has created, which is incredibly inspiring, but the one thing that we are trying to do with the Restart project is to reconnect that wonderful pool of knowledge and information with ways that we can bring that into the real world. Now, there is a fantastic techie and DIY and hacker community that contributes tips all over the internet. But we know very well, based on the kind of participation we get at our events, that the vast majority of people in our target group, which is real people of all kinds, are not necessarily able to make sense by themselves alone of the problems that iFixit guides are describing and the solutions they're providing. So in a sense, we come to the point where it's really easy to access the information about how something could be repaired in theory, but we would like to reconnect the people able to apply those fixes in real life so that they can teach each other and things that are deemed to be wasted are no longer wasted as a result. So that if you have a printer that stopped printing all of a sudden and it sounds very suspicious, you are right, it is suspicious and it can be fixed. It's just that you need to find the right solution, which might involve finding a very specific liquid that will clean up the connection between the cartridge and the header, or find a solution to reset a mysterious counter in a printer that prevents it from printing once the manufacturer thinks that you've printed enough with it. And we've seen this and we fixed it. And it was an Epson printer. And I'm saying this because I'm saying Epson, and I haven't mentioned the magical fruity brand, because we see the problem as being incredibly systemic.
Yeah.
It is, in a sense, pointless, although kind of trendy, to focus on one specific brand, because we have problems from all kinds of sides. We have software problems, meaning products are made with defects, and manufacturers are more interested in bringing about the next generation of the product instead than supporting that original product and fixing the things that could be fixed. That's one thing. And we have obviously hardware problems, how certain devices are built with obsolescence. And so a typical example is tablets. That imagine if 5 years ago you had bought a computer that didn't accept a USB stick for taking data in and out of it. Would you have bought it? Tablets, people are accepting compromises that are just astonishing. The fact that you buy an object that might cost £400 or £500 and you're not able, when in 2 years' time you might need more storage space, you are not allowed to take it apart and change the hard drive to a bigger size. Or if a new generation network to connect to the internet is unveiled, you can't just upgrade that part. That is completely insane. Of course, we can't change everything all at once, and that's why we decided to start with people, because people are the ones that are going to make the difference. People and communities. This is all about us becoming more informed consumers, and also taking a little bit more time, just as much as we take time to make informed decisions about the food we eat, what we try to grow, how we travel, and etc. We also have a lot to learn about the technical objects in our lives, and look forward to a more collaborative and resilient technology world. Thank you.
What I want to talk about is why I think a new materialism, a different relationship with stuff, is part of the solution to what Liz and Philippe were talking about in terms of increases in mining, increases in resource use. If we're looking at a paradigm shift, if we're looking at complete transformation, which has ripples all the way down the system, I think that learning to love the material world that we're part of transforms our relationship with stuff in such a way that it cuts off demand for ever more stuff at source. So I think that to date, like an abusive relationship with the material world, materialism has become synonymous with consumerism. It's wasteful, it's debt-fueled, and it's ultimately unsatisfying. And I think that if we develop a richer, more meaningful relationship with the things that we own and share, that can be a way in which I think there are both benefits for us, for our communities, and benefits for the earth. Until things like the Restart Project and the iFixit Project emerged, I think that the way that the Green Movement had sort of dealt with consumerism was either on the one hand to sort of to argue for complete abstinence and giving up, the sort of hair shirt miserabilism of denial. And I don't think that's the kind of, I don't think that abstinence is a is a good way in. It doesn't do anything to change our relationship. It just sort of invites self-flagellation. And on the other hand, we had a movement which was about, well, it's okay, we can carry on consuming, but we'll consume green things, so that you could have your designer shoes as long as they had a recycled sole, or you could have a car as long as it was a Prius. And I think, as Hugo kind of pointed out, I haven't heard the example of the laptop, that actually, if you're replacing one thing with another, there's a huge amount of embedded resource use in that. So what can we do instead? I think, as I said, we need to escape this old form of materialism, and instead I think a culture of making and mending that Hugo and others are spearheading is synonymous with many of the things that we know support well-being. On a sort of practical level, here in the global north, when we're in the middle of a global economic downturn, at a point where we know that we also need to substantially reduce resource use to prevent potentially catastrophic runaway climate change, that I think a new materialism in which we make what we have last much longer, there's a huge potential for ample quality employment for everyone, and that's particularly critical at a point when we know that recent data has shown that one in five young people aged 16 to 24 in the UK can't find work. So this is an agenda that's about not only living better on the earth, but also living better in our lives and with one another. And when it comes to that, when it comes to those kind of consumer issues, the green agenda has been distilled for decades, and we've heard much about that already. Instead of a throwaway society, we know we should move to one in which value is created in more of a closed use, in which we repair, reduce, reuse, recycle, and many other appropriate actions prefixed with re. So this is then it's a shift from a consumer society to more of a producer society. And it suggests a world in which we roll back our gradual de-skilling and the impoverishment of work, where we all confidently know how to cook a meal for ourselves, to stitch a garment or paint a wall even. It's a world where we don't just consume collaboratively, we produce collaboratively too. And it's already taken off. I don't think we need a tabloid newspaper to prove something for us, but the Metro called sharing the new rock and roll. Well, turns out you're rock and roll. I think that sort of behind that, and behind the sort of the fact that it is taking off, it is happening at the grassroots. I think that apart from the fact that learning how to make and mend things for ourselves, learning new crafts and skills, doesn't just equip us better to a changing world. It doesn't just equip us to respond better to a changing world, but it also helps us to connect to the material world that we're part of. When we work with materials, we learn something critical about limits, about give and take. And it's not just a hobby, it's also, as I said at the beginning, it's also creating skilled, meaningful employment. There are furniture recycling projects that are springing up across the country, providing training for some of those young people who aren't in employment. There's a furniture recycling project in Gloucestershire that provides an average of 12,000 items of furniture for families on low incomes each year, while providing training and work experience for 60 young people. So there are ways in which it's providing affordable resources for people who don't have much spare money, and also providing training and quality employment. There's a workers' cooperative in the Lee Valley that's brought food growing back to what was originally the breadbasket of London. Volunteers at the first allotment in 2001 could take home a share of the harvest in return for their labour. So there are ways in which this is responding to economic need and practical and community need, as well as our need to reduce resource use. And I think that sort of more broadly outside electronic equipment, which is a huge part of the picture, an economy that needs to boost demand, where we want to have more people active in our communities without raising consumption, is one that calls for practical people and artists in equal measure, menders, makers and entertainers. It requires a huge growth in practical services that boosts the number of plumbers, electricians, builders, carpenters, farmers and engineers, as much as upholsterers, as seamstresses, painters, sport coaches and storytellers. So I think it's kind of, if our needs are met in other ways, it cuts off that false desire for consumption that we're encouraged into by the advertising industry. Because I think one thing we haven't touched on this evening is the way in which this desire for the next model, the new thing, is partly embedded in the built-in obsolescence that means that stuff just breaks and we can't fix it. There's also a huge multi-million pound industry that is encouraging us that we will feel better, be smarter, be more popular if we buy the next thing. But the problem with that is, as psychologists and economists have worked out, is that we very quickly adapt to that change status. They call it hedonic adaptation. So as soon as we've got the new thing, the luster very quickly wears off and we're just where we were before. But very soon you're caught in this hedonic treadmill where you go after the next short-lived high. And you're constantly chasing after the next thing. And I think, I suppose what I'm trying to do with the new materialism is to begin a kind of a movement that sort of neutralizes that appeal by developing more pleasurable, meaningful, lasting relationships that foster, in terms of care and community, that foster all of that foster all of the values that well-being says is good for our real well-being, and good for our communities. We need to find employment for people while also transforming the economy. I think that things like a Green New Deal, where, for example, similar amounts, the vast sums that were found to bail out the banks, could be invested in local small-scale renewables, localising food production, creating active employment and transforming our economy to an economy of better and not more. I think there are kind of practical things like creative ways that we could end built-in obsolescence, like having a minimum 10-year guarantee on any new products, or a We Will Mend It pledge from retailers, where we rate different retailers according to repairability. I think support for apprenticeships would also increase and revalue manual labour, which has kind of been looked down upon as second rate to the knowledge economy. I think that by sort of looking down on manual labour, we've lost something that deeply connects us in communities, but also that connects us to the earth and to the material world that we're part of. Which is why I co-wrote a pamphlet called The New Materialism, surprise, surprise, with Andrew Sims. And when we got to the end, we sort of thought that actually what we wanted to try and do was just to kind of try and draw out a few of the principles of new materialism. And we wanted this to be in the spirit of a world that's made and remade and repaired and cared for. We wanted this to be a collaborative endeavour, so it's on the website. I'm going to read them out for now, but it's an open invitation to people to add to them, change them, remake them, and reinvent them. So we started with liking stuff is okay, healthy even. We can learn to love and find pleasure in the material world. Wherever practical and possible, develop lasting relationships with the things you have by having and making nothing that is designed to last less than 10 years. Get to know things. Before you acquire it, find out at least 3 things about it. Love stuff. Mend, maintain and reuse things until it is no longer possible, and only then recycle them as a last resort. Get active. Only acquire something new if you're also learning a new and useful skill. Share. Look at your things, think about what your friends might need or could benefit from, and share at least 1 thing a week. Thank you.
I fix it as a community website dedicated to helping people learn how to fix things. Our mission is to teach everybody in the world how to fix everything.
it's a bold goal, and but we've made dramatic progress. So we started out because we found out that the manufacturers were limiting access to information as a form of planned obsolescence. So I started out trying to get a service manual for a fruit company, and when I wasn't able to find it on the internet, I got kind of confused. And I looked around, I kept searching, and said, where is this iBook service manual? Because I knew there was one, and I couldn't have it. And it turned out that they use copyright law to prevent you and me from knowing how to repair things. They say, we wrote it, we have the copyright, and we have the right to prevent the public from having access to it. And that kind of pissed me off. And so I wrote a new manual to replace theirs, and I posted it online for free. And I said, I explicitly waive my copyright on this, so all of you can take my manual and do what you want with it. And that's actually pretty exciting. Those manuals go far and wide. We were in Shenzhen, China the other day, and we were in the repair market, and we looked up, and one of our photos was 40 feet by 20 feet on a billboard, and someone was advertising their repair service using our photo, which we got excited about. We found that if you make it easy to repair things, more people will do it. If you're interested in getting a tablet, if you go to iFixit, we have a tablet repairability chart where you can see which tablets are easy to fix, which tablets are not. And what we have found is that every time something breaks and you take it apart, if you fix it or not, you've at least learned something. And if all of us can learn from each other, we've got an opportunity to really have an impact. On iFixit, we have step-by-step photo manuals. Or you can also, if you have a Android or iPhone, go to the App Store, download the iFixit app. It's free, and then you will literally have the largest repair manual the world has ever seen in your pocket. And you'll be able to see photos of what's inside. So one question I get a lot, and I imagine you get a lot, is, I have this broken thing, can I fix it? And the answer is, go and look at the iFixit guide, see what's involved, and then if it's something you feel comfortable doing on your own, great, jump right in. If it's something you're not quite sure, bring it down to the restart
project. Yeah.
And then maybe you can work on it with a friend. Or maybe it's something that's beyond the scope of you, and so you find a local repair shop that can do it, and we support local repairs. So we're really excited. We find that getting the information online then allows local communities to really grow and thrive.